Maligayang Sabado!
Ansur, Kwai La!
Hengbukhan, Anshul Saseo!
Malipayong Sabado!
Isabata, Elishe!
Magandang Sabado!
Feliz Sabado!
Malipayong Adlang Ipapakulay!
Feliz Sabado!
Hello and good morning everyone. Good morning children. Welcome to our children's story this morning. Our story is very interesting because we're right here up in the ocean front. And my story is about Jesus and the storm. Jesus stood in a boat, a fishing boat with oars and sail, and talked to many people who had come to hear him. All day long, Jesus told them stories. When it was evening, Jesus said to his helpers, "Let us cross over to the other side of the lake and rest." So Jesus' helpers untied the boat. They pushed it from the shore and raised the sail. One man sat in the back of the boat to guide it with a steering tiller. The boat moved slowly at first and then faster across the quiet blue water. A round yellow moon came up over the lake and the stars twinkled high overhead. Jesus was very tired that he lay down with his head on a pillow and was soon sound asleep. The man at the back steered carefully and the boat sailed on and on and on. Suddenly, a fierce wind began to blow. It was a black cloud over the moon. It blew black clouds over the stars, and it whipped the water into huge, angry waves. The waves tossed the boat this way and that way and up and down. There was lightning, there was thunder, and the man at the tiller tried to steer the boat, but he couldn't. And other men tried to row the boat with oars, but they couldn't. Water filled the boat and it began to sink. The men were afraid. They woke up Jesus. "Lord, save us, we perish," they cried. And Jesus heard their cry for help. And he felt the angry wind. He saw the lightning flash and he heard the noisy thunder. But Jesus was not afraid. He stood up and said to the wind and waves, "Peace, be still." The wind stopped blowing. The waves were still. And the clouds went away. And the stars twinkled again. The boat sailed on the sparkling path that the moon made on the water and crossed to the other side of the lake. "Why were you afraid?" Jesus asked his helpers. "Why were you afraid when I was with you?" So Jesus says to boys and girls today, don't be afraid when the lightning flashes and the thunder crashes and the strong winds blow. "I am with you always," says Jesus, "in the dark and in the storm. I will never leave you. Don't be afraid." That's the end of our story, children. The story is from My Bible Friends. And Jesus told us, even not only for the children, but also for adults, wherever you are, whatever your situation right now, don't be afraid. God is always with you. See you next time. Bye-bye.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. I'm so glad that you can join us virtually and in church today. It is the second time that we can worship together, of course, with all the guidelines to follow, but it's really good to be in the house of God. But for those of you who are in your homes today, don't worry. It's the same blessing that God has for us. And I'm so glad that you could join us. We have a special guest speaker today, all the way across the globe. And I'm so glad that he accepted our invitation. Pastor Charles served in the pastoral work for 9 years as a youth pastor, a school chaplain, a senior pastor, and a church planter in Canada before he was called to serve as the communications director for the British Columbia Conference in Vancouver, Canada. God has blessed him in his ministry that expanded into so many amazing opportunities and experiences that his churches that he pastored have been so blessed by his leadership that they were able to reach the communities where they are. And it's amazing. And because of this, after 5 years of being the director for communications at the British Columbia Conference, the Lord called him to an amazing adventure. So he is now currently serving as the Adventist Disaster and Relief Agency country director for the country of Uganda. And you know that Uganda has been a very challenging place to serve because of so many different things that have happened in the country and the countries around. And the Lord has blessed him to serve in that category. He will explain to us and share with us amazing things of what God has been doing in this ministry. But look, here's what you're gonna know about our speaker today. He has been my housemate, and we lived together in one room in the dormitory as I was going to school at Mountain View College in the southern part of the island of the Philippines. That's why I know him so well. And so let me introduce to you our speaker, a person who loves Jesus, dedicated his life to serve him even in a foreign country of Uganda. His name is Pastor Charles Ed II Aguilar. Let's have a word of prayer. Loving God, our hearts are open. We are ready to receive your blessing today. And Lord, may you touch us powerfully. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you so much for inviting me to your church service today. I bring you greetings from Uganda, the Pearl of Africa. Our borders are still closed due to COVID-19. However, public transportation has been given a green light with restrictions. Schools and churches are still restricted. Any public gatherings of more than 10 people are also prohibited. However, this has not dampened the spirit of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Uganda. The church still continues to serve her members through the use of TV, radio, Facebook, and YouTube. In Uganda, government statistics show that there are more than 1.2 million Seventh-day Adventists. The Seventh-day Adventist Church in Uganda is alive and healthy. I hope that your church are finding ways to be relevant during this COVID-19 pandemic. As a worldwide church, I find it very encouraging to see how other Adventist churches have continued to stay relevant. A church is not a small church. We are a big church. According to the available statistics, as of December 2019, our church membership worldwide stands at 21 million. The United States and Canada is at 1.2 million members. We have the world's second largest integrated network of schools. We have more than 8,000 integrated schools worldwide with more than 1.8 million students every single year. We also have the largest Protestant integrated network of hospitals and clinics worldwide. We have more than 600 healthcare institutions. The total does not include the nursing homes, retirement homes, orphanages, and children's homes. In 2018 alone, Adventist hospitals and clinics provided healthcare assistance to more than 22 million people worldwide. According to one research published in USA Today, the Seventh-day Adventist Church was recognized as the fastest growing Christian denomination in North America. The Seventh-day Adventist Church is the most racially diverse religious group in the United States. Now, please note that the Seventh-day Adventist Church did not just grow to become one of the largest and most organized denominations in the world. A lot of our church growth can be credited to our traditions and theology or framework. So what does it mean to be a Seventh-day Adventist? One of the critical character or framework of Adventist theology is this: demonstration is important to God. I'd like to repeat this again. Demonstration is important to God. What do we mean by demonstration is important to God? It means that the kingdom of God cannot be merely pronounced. It must be demonstrated. When we say and proclaim what we believe as Seventh-day Adventists, we must demonstrate it. There's no such thing as a closet Adventist. Although we do have lots of close at Venice. But our traditions dictate that to be a faithful Seventh-day Adventist is to show action. If we say we love people, then we must love with action, not merely with words. 1 John 3:17 to 18 says, if anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. This is critical in Adventist framework of theology. Although, to be honest, I struggled with this text. When I was pastoring in Canada for more than 15 years and traveled all around visiting other Adventist churches and congregations, I would meet with the leaders and elders and the pastors. And I see that most of the Adventist congregations that I have visited in Canada are too focused in their own world, totally disconnected to what is happening around their communities. That is not what Adventist tradition is about. When the church sees injustice happening in the world and in their community, the church needs to do something. When we see tyranny, hatred, and cruelty in the world and in the community, we need to do something. As Adventists, our tradition dictates that God's kingdom of justice, compassion, and peace must be on display for the community to see. Demonstration is important to God. This is critical. This is a critical framework in Adventist theology. You cannot be a closet Adventist. Ellen White wrote, God designs that the sick, the unfortunate, those possessed by evil spirits shall hear his voice through his church. Through his human agents, God desires to be a comforter, such as the world has never seen before. Now, who is this Ellen White that I just quoted? As Adventists, we believe in the prophets, both recorded in the Bible and those not recorded in the Bible. Ellen White is one of our prophets. She is not a prophet to the Methodists, to the Anglicans, to the Baptists, to Islam. Ellen White is a prophet to the Seventh-day Adventists. The Adventist Church will not be where it is right now without Ellen White. She is part of our history. She and part of our rich Adventist traditions. So I am not going to apologize for who Ellen White is. Demonstration is important to God. For more than 150 years, the Seventh-day Adventist Church have been committed to demonstrating God's love and justice in this hurting world. Many of our pioneers that formed the church in 1863 were social reformers and radicals. They were troublemakers. In fact, they encouraged civil disobedience for the sake of social justice. Seventh-day Adventist Church started just several months after Abraham Lincoln made it official that slaves within any state or designated part of a state in rebellion shall be then henceforward and forever free. But as you probably would have learned, the Emancipation Proclamation didn't officially end all slavery in the U.S. One of our Seventh-day Adventist founders, Joseph Bates, was a strong anti-slavery advocate. Joseph Bates wrote, all who embrace this doctrine of the Second Coming would and must necessarily be advocates of temperance and the abolition of slavery. And those who oppose this doctrine of the second coming would not be very effective laborers in moral reform. Basically, what Joseph Bates was saying is, if you really are a Seventh-day Adventist, you must demonstrate that you are against alcohol consumption and against slavery. Demonstration is important to God. The kingdom of God cannot merely be pronounced. It must be demonstrated. This is part of our Adventist theology, history, and traditions. Now, how far would our Adventist pioneers go to live out this framework, this theology? How about far enough that Adventists would risk their lives and livelihood? How about that? Would any of you be willing to put your lives and careers on the line just for the sake of justice and compassion? Ellen White, our prophet, instructed and encouraged all Adventists to disregard a law called the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850, which imposed a $1,000 fine, which would be $32,871 2020 inflation, and up to 6 months in prison for those who disobeyed the law and failed to return escaping slaves to their supposed owners. Ellen White advised, when the laws of men conflict with the word of and law of God, we are to obey the latter. Whatever the consequences may be, the law of our land requiring us to deliver a slave to his master, we are not to obey. And we must abide the consequences of violating the law. When I first read this statement from Ellen White, I was shocked. Did you know what she just wrote here? Ellen White was encouraging civil disobedience for the sake of social justice and compassion. Here is another example. In 1833, thousands of slaves escaped from the United States and followed the North Star and settled in Canada via the illegal Underground Railroad. For those of you who haven't heard of the Underground Railroad, you can Google it and you will be fascinated by the bravery of the women and men who operated this illegal network. In a nutshell, the Underground Railroad was a network of secret roads and safe houses established in the United States and used by enslaved African Americans to escape to free states and Canada. Do you know who was part of that illegal Underground Railroad? John Byington, the Seventh-day Adventist Church first GC president, and John P. Kellogg, the father of Harvey, the serial inventor, offered their homes as stations for the Underground Railroad. These Adventist officials showed great courage and they took risks to help those oppressed by injustice. Do you know what really annoys me as a pastor? Really annoys me when I see Adventist churches not standing up for justice and compassion and mercy. Why? Because justice, compassion, and mercy are part of our DNA as a church. When we see hatred, we respond with compassion. When we see systematic discrimination and racism, we respond with action and call for justice. See, slavery was not the only social issue the early Adventists were concerned about. Adventists were active in the temperance movement, which sought to counter the growing influence of alcohol. Ellen White wrote, "The advocates of temperance fail to do their whole duty unless they exert their influence by precept and example, by voice and pen and vote, in favor of prohibition and total abstinence." Let me repeat that again. Exert their influence by voice and by vote. Again, it's back to our Adventist framework and traditions. Demonstration is important to God. A closet Adventist is a useless Christian. Now, why is the consumption of alcohol a huge Adventist issue? See, for some of us today, this alcohol issue might seem like a bland or a non-issue. But alcohol consumption had significant relevance to social justice themes in our Adventist worldview and history. For instance, our pioneers argued that alcohol consumption was contributing to violence and crime, which filled prisons and increased taxes. Furthermore, Ellen White connected alcohol abuse with domestic abuse. Ellen White wrote, "Look upon the drunkard's home. Mark the squalid poverty, the wretchedness, the woe that are reigning there. See the once happy wife fleeing before her maniac husband. Hear her plead for mercy as the cruel blows fall on her shrinking form. Where are the sacred vows made at the marriage altar? Where's the love to cherish, the strength to protect her now? Hence, our church has complete abstinence from alcohol." Not only did our pioneers encourage a response to intentional civil disobedience against slavery and alcoholism, but our early Adventists were also heavily engaged in social service. In 1893, John Harvey Kellogg opened the Chicago Medical Mission, offering free medical dispensary, free baths, free laundry, an evening school for Chinese, and a visiting nurse service. The ministry expanded, adding a children's daycare, a soup lunch, and a home for men's temporary housing needs. Now think about this. The Chinese were building the railroad system in the U.S., and injustice, racism, and discrimination were written all over history. So what did we do as a church? We provided these awesome services for the Chinese immigrants who were discriminated against and racially profiled by society. Compassion, social justice is part of who we are as a church. This is part of our DNA. Also in Chicago, the Adventists opened the Lifeboat Mission, which provided a dispensary, laundry facilities, a rescue home for the unwed mothers and prostitutes, and a restaurant along with gospel meetings. How radical was that? Can you imagine doing this today in your community? A church building a safe house for prostitutes? Adventists were known to engage in social action. However, what has happened to our church? I mean, if social action and compassion and justice are at the heart of our Adventist history, how are you doing in church? I have even met Adventists who even have apologized that they are affiliated with the church. If we truly are Adventists, in its historic terms, we got to be proud that we stand for compassion and justice. in Uganda. Seventh-day Adventist Church through ADRA continues to practice compassion and social justice. Watch this.
I left Congo after armed militias started violently harassing our villages and enforced unimaginable atrocities, especially to the men of the village. Most of the times, these armed militias would come to the villages and demand ransom for the men they have held as hostages. If the family couldn't come up with the money, the armed militias would kill their hostages. To protect myself and my family, I decided to travel alone to Uganda. By doing so, if I get ambushed in the bushes by the armed militias, at least it will only be me that would be harmed and not my family. I arrived safely in Uganda in 2014 and was resettled in Ramwanja refugee settlement. Because of the dangerous situations in Congo, it took me 4 years before I could see my family again. 4 years without seeing my beautiful wife and children was too much to bear. I desire to be with my family, see my children grow, and be with my wife. Then in 2018, I took the risk and brought my family to Uganda. With my family now in Uganda, my greatest challenge is to provide food for my young family. When I was living by myself, I could take care of myself, but now I have to make sure my family is taken care of. The United Nations World Food Program has been assisting us with food. However, that help was not enough to sustain my growing family for a month. So I moved out of the refugee settlement and took a job in another town, 50 kilometers away from home. It was good working in that corn mill. It brought extra income for my family to supplement the food given by the UN World Food Program. However, my children got very sick, so I had to go back to the settlement and help with my sick children. I was devastated to be back in the settlement as I had an excellent job at the mill. I needed to find another trade to keep my family from getting hungry. So I started tilling the ground and started growing simple crops for home and sell to the fellow refugees. The small money I earned from selling my crops and vegetables, I started another business, making bricks out of mud and selling them to my fellow refugees. This was good business. It gave me extra income for my young family. One day, a friend informed me that ADRA was looking for volunteers to help with their World Food Program project, and so I went and applied for the volunteer job. ADRA took me in as a volunteer in charge of loading food in hard distribution operations and got a stipend of $4 for my duties. With my vegetable gardens and brick business providing complementary income to feed my family, the new income I received from ADRA now gives me a room to dream. Not only can I buy small types of furniture for my little house, but now I can build a better house for my family. ADRA has not only given me a job, but has also given me a room to dream of building a better house. This house stands because of ADRA.
When you look at our name, Seventh-day Adventists, it stands for two things. Seventh-day Sabbath, today, the reason why we worship on Saturday instead of Sunday. And second, Adventists, waiting for the second coming of Jesus, our Messiah. For the sake of time, I am going to just cover the Sabbath. So let me give you a few thoughts about this Sabbath thing. Most of us don't know what that really means. See, there's a relationship between the Sabbath and compassion. There's a relationship between Sabbatarianism and humanitarianism. Christian Sabbath keeping means following the example of the Lord of the Sabbath, Jesus Christ. We hear a lot about Sabbath keeping. What does Sabbath keeping really mean? Let me ask another question. Did you know that the four Gospels tell of seven miracles of healing that Jesus performed on the Sabbath? The man with the withered hand, Matthew 12:9-13. The demon-possessed man, Mark 1:21-26. Peter's mother-in-law, Luke 4:38-39. The bent-over woman, Luke 13:10-16. The man with dropsy, Luke 14:1-5. The crippled man at the pool of Bethesda, John 5:5-9. The man born blind, John 9:1-14. These are all chronic conditions. We're not talking about sudden, unavoidable, immediate needs here. Jesus could have waited for Sunday to do the healing, but Jesus chose to heal on the Sabbath. Why? Because Sabbath keeping is about routine healing, compassion, and wholeness, not just dealing with emergencies. Jesus says that the Sabbath was made for men, for human beings. Its purpose is humanitarian. Its purpose is humane. Sabbatarians who are not humane or compassionate are not Sabbath keepers in the manner of Jesus. Can you imagine what your Sabbath church services would look like if you approached the Sabbath that way? People would be coming to your church not just because of the awesome fellowship and music and your pastor's sermon, but people would want to be part of your faith community because they know your faith community offers compassion, healing, and hope. That is what the Sabbath is for. Yes, the Sabbath is for worship and fellowship, yet Jesus didn't emphasize this aspect of the day. Yes, Sabbath is for rest, yet Jesus doesn't emphasize rest either. Again and again, Jesus connects Sabbath and healing, Sabbath and compassion, the Sabbath and justice. Jesus even defines his ministry with an Old Testament passage. Jesus could have used any one of many other Old Testament texts to introduce the meaning of his ministry, but he doesn't. Jesus chose Isaiah 61:1-2. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery for the sight of the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Jesus refers to the year of the Lord's favor, the Jubilee. What is the year of the Jubilee? According to Leviticus, slaves and prisoners would be freed, debts would be forgiven, and the mercies of God would be particularly manifest. Jesus has in mind the sabbatical system of Leviticus, a system that was rich with compassion for the earth, compassion for the slave, compassion for the widow, the orphan, and the man in debt. The most prominent of Jesus' ministry is compassion. Watch this video.
When I finish my studies, I want to be a lawyer that fights for women's rights. Growing up in Congo, I have seen and experienced how women were mistreated and raped. I fled Congo back in 2014 with my family. The rebels slaughtered our cows, burned our houses and crops. I saw the rebels kill my grandfather and cousins. We were running for our lives day and night. Sometimes we sleep in the bushes and hide in the caves during the day until we reached Uganda. Uganda is a real blessing. The government gave us a small plot of land so we can start a new life. However, the services in the refugee settlement were very challenging. We used to only have one meal a day. United Nations World Food Program gave us corn flour and beans. Clean water was also challenging. We couldn't afford the school fees, so we missed school a lot. My parents would sometimes sell the food ration received from World Food Program. This food is supposed to be for our monthly ration. But my parents would sell the food just so they can pay the school fees. Sometimes my parents and brothers and sisters won't have food for days, just so I can go to school. I would also miss school days during my menstruation period since I didn't have access to sanitary pads. Also, in school, there was discrimination. I was discriminated and made fun of because I struggled with the English language. Just like the rest of Congolese refugees who spoke mostly French, at times, I get so discouraged learning English. I thought of just leaving school and getting married. But my parents encouraged me to work harder and complete my school work. These are just some of the challenges I face in achieving my dream to become a lawyer someday. When Adra came to our school, I felt so good that my dream might be coming sooner than later. Adra built our school a dormitory. Adra also helped the school by starting gardening and agriculture. Adra also provided French and English teacher who helped us in integration from French speaking to English speaking. Adra, together with AfriPads, also provided us with reusable sanitary pads. Now we will not miss school because of our mastery period. One day when I become a lawyer, I would like to go back to Congo to make Congo a better place to live. No more war.
In Matthew 25, Jesus paints an end-time scene. As Adventists, we believe that Jesus is coming again, the coming apocalypse, the coming judgment. And Jesus basically tells that in the last days, in the coming judgment, there will be only two types of people. Matthew 25. The world is divided into two. And what is the issue? What is the end time issue? Basically, Jesus asks, did you feed me when I was hungry? Did you quench my thirst when I had no water? Did you clothe me when I was cold? Did you include me when I was lonely? Did you visit me when I was in prison? Did you care for me when I was sick? In other words, the judge who presides over the final judgment asks the church, were you compassionate. As Adventist Sabbath keepers, we ought to expend a lot of energy confronting poverty, abuse, hatred, violence, and sexual crime in your community and around the world. We must work to end systemic racism outside the church and within our churches. We must fight the good fight of making certain that both outside and inside the church, women are treated with the same dignity and are given the same opportunities as men. We must continue to be advocates for the homeless people in our community, the migrant, the illegal immigrant, the refugee. Remember, Jesus was once homeless. Jesus was a refugee. If we are indeed true-blooded Seventh-day Adventists, then we would not sit on the sidelines and be complicit while injustice is happening around our communities and in our country. We must do something. The Lord of the Sabbath calls us to compassion, justice, and love. Even during this COVID-19 pandemic, your church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, has never stopped making an impact around the world. Your church did something. Watch this video.
I was lonely, yeah. I needed someone to see me through. I was at the end of my rope. I needed someone to cut me loose. Then an angel out of the blue the sense that I might make it through, and somehow I survived with no rhyme or reason. And now I know I made it through the miracle of you and oh, baby.
I know the color of love really lives inside of you.
I'm going to end my part. Now I'm going to challenge you. What will your church do? My prayer is your church will not be complicit. May God's grace give your church the power to do something today. Add your voice to the voiceless. Be an advocate to those who have suffered injustice and discrimination. May your church be part of a healing process in your communities. May your church be a blessing to your communities. God bless you all. Stay safe and wear that mask. Bye for now.